Welcome to First Parish in Needham, Unitarian Universalist. I am Roberta Altamari, your Interim Director of Lifespan Religious Education. First Parish is a Unitarian Universalist congregation founded in 1711, along with the town of Needham. We are proud to be certified as a welcoming congregation for our inclusivity of people of all sexual orientations and gender identities and expressions. As a green sanctuary for our commitment to addressing the climate crisis, and a level two sanctuary supporting congregation for our work in immigration reform and anti-deportation efforts. Whether you are a first-time visitor or a lifelong member, you can learn more about all that's happening at First Parish by going to our website, uuneedham.org, or following us on Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube. As you know, what's happening right now at the congregation is very different than usual because of the coronavirus pandemic. Our building is closed and we are gathering online only. Our coming-of-age youth, mentors, and families have worked creatively to share a meaningful version of our beloved rite of passage, Coming of Age Sunday, for you today. Our First Parish community has become creative about how we can stay in touch and renew our spirits without meeting in person. And we hope you have been plugging into our Zoom gatherings and other opportunities throughout the week. For example, you are invited to our Zoom social hour directly following this worship service, and that will include the chance to meet our five coming-of-age youth in person. Please find the link in your Saturday Bell Notes email. If you're joining us for the first time this Sunday, or you don't know what we're talking about when we refer to Saturday Bell Notes or the emailed order of service, you can sign up to be included in these emails next week by going to our website, uuneedham.org, and clicking Get Involved newsletter, or sending a request by email to office@uuneedham.org. We know this way of worshiping and gathering together is an adjustment for all of us. However, our sincere hope and prayer is that these online services and connection opportunities will help us keep the physical distance required during this coronavirus pandemic without losing much of our spiritual, emotional, and social closeness that we treasure in our faith community. As we prepare to recognize these five young people who are coming of age today, I share with you words from Michael Young. Let the ceremony remind us all that we have a solemn obligation to build with young people a world in which their horizons may continually expand and their spirits soar. May we participate as wisely as we are able in their religious growth. May we find the wisdom to guide them unto themselves and the trust to free them to become themselves. Above all, may we offer a quality of fellowship in which they feel the bonds of love and concern that bind us together with all of humankind. As you enjoy today's service, I invite you to also reflect on your own self as a growing and evolving being, and to give yourself the same loving support and trust. What did you believe when you were their age? How have your beliefs changed? What have been your biggest aha moments and growing stories? How might they change as you continue to grow and evolve? Welcome again to all, and good morning.
In honor of our siblings, we share with you our chalice lighting.
Our Unitarian Universalist beliefs are expansive and lead the way into wider and deeper understanding.
Our beliefs are like sunshine, blessing children with the warmth of happiness.
Our beliefs are bonds in a world community where sincere differences beauty the pattern.
Our beliefs are like gateways, opening wide vistas for exploration.
Please join us in singing hymn number 34, Though I May Speak with Bravest Fire.
Please now join with us in saying the words of this congregation's covenant, the promises we make to each other and to the world.
You'll find the words in your order of service in Saturday's bell notes. We gather as a loving community to encourage and comfort one another.
We gather as a diverse community to support each other in our search for spiritual truth.
We gather as a service community to live our beliefs through action and care for our world.
We've come to the time in our service when we share joys and concerns that are very close to our hearts and lives. In this new format, joys and sorrows are emailed to me by Thursday night, and I will share them aloud and light candles for you all. As we are making the link to our virtual Sunday services public and open to all visitors, be aware that we cannot guarantee that news shared in joys and concerns will stay within the First Parish community. So if you wish to share in a more private setting, I encourage you to reach out to me or to our Pastoral Care Associate of the Week, whose name is included in your emailed order of service. Let us now hear the joys and sorrows of our community.
A candle of sorrow from Doug M. and Corey L. to note the passing of Doug's mom, Marion Polly McFadden, on Sunday, May 10th. Polly was surrounded by her loved ones in her final days, and she will be dearly missed. A candle of joy from Jay and Eleanor R., in excited anticipation of becoming grandparents for the first time. Their son and daughter-in-law are expecting a baby boy in mid-September. A candle of joy from me, Sally, for a happy conclusion to my search for a new ministry. I will be joining the ministry team at the UU Church in Urbana, Illinois, as their associate minister for congregational life. The congregation is a great match, and though I'll miss Needham, I'm excited to be getting back to my roots in the Midwest. A candle of both celebration and concern from Susanna Q., daughter of Leslie and Ed. who is working with COVID patients in the ICU at Beth Israel. When she was heading into four night shifts in a row, she received a card from the First Parish Pastoral Care Team thanking her for her frontline work. She says, "Receiving that card as I went into work really helped my spirit and reminded me why we're doing this. Thank you from the bottom of my heart." And I light one final candle for all the joys and sorrows that are still carried quietly in our hearts. During this time of physical separation, let us not forget that we are still deeply interconnected and bound together through mutual love, support, and commitment to each other.
This congregation has been supported by the volunteer time and treasure of its members and friends since its founding in 1711. In those 300 years, this community has seen some tough times, but we're still here. This is a time in our service when we, the modern keepers of this church, offer to give what we can to build and sustain the world we envision. In celebration of this Coming of Age Sunday, the youth leading our service got to choose the organization we'll be sharing our collection with. It is in their honor that we will give half of today's plate collection to the South Middlesex Opportunity Council. The Opportunity Council is a local nonprofit organized with the goal of improving the quality of life of low-income and disadvantaged families through advocacy, education, direct support, and community building. The Opportunity Council helps run the Pathways Family Shelter, where we send our mitten tree donations every Christmas. The youth know that families who are food or housing insecure are being hit particularly hard in these uncertain times, and they wanted our congregation's generosity to have a direct impact on our neighbors right here in Massachusetts. To donate to today's offering, you can use our Text to Give program. Our text to give number is 73256. That's 73256. And instructions on how to use text to give should be on your screen, or you can find them in your emailed order of service. Or you can mail a check made out to First Parish in Needham to our address at 23 Dedham Ave, Needham, Massachusetts, 02492. Whether you're using a check or your phone, please make sure you specify whether your donation is intended for today's plate collection or if it should be counted toward your pledge for either this or next church year. Thank you so much for everything that you're able to give to help support and sustain this congregation and the work of our vital community partners. Please take these next few moments to give what you can, and know it will be gratefully received.
In honor of our beloved's growing and inspiring, I share with you the song "Swimming to the Other Side" by Pat Humphreys. We are living in the great Big Dipper. We are washed by the very same rain. We are swimming in the stream together, some in power and some in pain. We can worship this ground we walk on, cherishing the beings that we live beside. Loving spirits will live forever. We're all swimming to the other side. I am alone and I am searching, hungering for answers in my time. I am balanced at the brink of wisdom. I'm impatient to receive a sign. I move forward with my senses open. Imperfection, it will be my crime. In humility, I will listen. We're all swimming to the other side. We are living beneath the great Big Dipper. We are washed by the very same rain. We are swimming in the stream together, some in power and some in pain. We can worship this ground we walk on, cherishing the beings that we live beside. Loving spirits will live forever. We're all swimming to the other side. On this journey through thoughts and feelings, binding intuition, my head, my heart, I am gathering the tools together. I'm preparing to do my part. All of those who have come before me band together to be my guide. Loving lessons that I will follow. We're all swimming to the other side. We are living in the great Big Dipper. We are washed by the very same rain. We are swimming in the stream together, some in power and some in pain. We can worship this ground we walk on, cherishing the beings that we live beside. Loving spirits will live forever. We're all swimming to the other side. When we get there, we'll discover all of the gifts we've been given to share have been with us since life's beginning, and we never noticed they were there. We can balance at the brink of wisdom, never recognizing that we've arrived. Loving spirits will live together. We're all swimming to the other side. We are living in great Big Dipper. We are washed by the very same rain. We are swimming in the stream together, some in power and some in pain. We can worship this ground we walk on, cherishing the beings that we live beside. Loving spirits will live forever. We're all swimming to the other side. Loving spirits will live forever. We're all swimming other side.
Our religious education approach emphasizes the cultivation of wonder, an encouragement of questions and independence, a celebration of diversity, and the search for truth and meaning. The 19th century Unitarian minister, William Ellery Channing, said it best, and our coming-of-age mentors will share it with you.
The great end in religious instruction is not to stamp our minds upon the young, but to stir up their own.
Not to make them see with our eyes, but to look inquiringly and steadily with their own.
Not to give them a definite amount of knowledge, but to inspire a fervent love of truth.
Not to form an outward regularity, but to touch inward springs.
Not to bind them with ineradicable prejudices to our particular sect of peculiar notions.
But to prepare them for impartial, conscientious judging of whatever subjects may be offered to their decision.
Not to burden the memory, but to quicken and strengthen the power of thought.
Not to impose religion upon them in the form of arbitrary rules, but to awaken the conscience, the moral discernment.
In a word, the great end is to awaken the soul, to excite and cherish spiritual life.
It has been our pleasure to be a part of the team working with these impressive young people.
Today is our beloved rite of passage service, and now is the time to recognize our five youth who are coming of age. Our coming of age program is comprehensive and wide-ranging. Among its many components are self-reflection, philosophical discussions, learning about Unitarian Universalist history and theology, an introduction to spiritual practices, an exploration of social justice issues, and consideration of our diverse beliefs and ways of being. In addition to their work as a group with myself and Kate Fitzgerald, each youth was matched with a mentor to work throughout the program. With their mentors, the youth had further opportunities to do individual exploration. The year culminates with each youth writing a personal credo. In some religions, after a similar period of learning and exploration, teens affirm that they believe the creed of their community. We, Unitarian Universalists, do not profess a creed. We affirm every person's freedom and responsibility to seek meaning for themselves. The word credo comes from the Latin. Often it is translated as I believe. James Fowler writes that what we believe are the things that we set our hearts on, the essential values that we give our hearts to. Throughout the program, we have asked our coming of agers to put into words what they give their hearts to, defining what for each of them gives purpose to their dreams and their actions. Listen to the depth and the diversity of their statements. Consider what they say and let it filter not only through your mind, but also your heart. Does someone say something that is deeply meaningful to you? Does something inspire you to ask questions of yourself? What these youth say today is an early statement of belief. As many of us have discovered, it's not a one-time thing, but a lifelong journey of mind, heart, and spirit. As Unitarian Universalists, we encourage people of all ages to wonder about, discuss, and explore what matters to them. We gather this morning to bear witness to what has meaning for these five young people and celebrate their achievement, and be inspired on our own journeys to look within and explore our beliefs. Let us begin by inviting Ethan, Kevin, Kaisa, Max, and Sebi to share their credos.
Good morning, I'm Dave Mackey. I am Ethan Zinner's mentor. Ethan is an amazing ninth grader who has great and varied talents. He's really into astrophysics, and he inspired me to read this great book called Astrophysics for People in a Hurry. Made me think a lot about things that I haven't thought about before. Ethan's thought a lot about the book, and it posed questions for him that you're going to hear about in just a minute in his credo. Ethan's also a musician, and as you heard earlier in the day, he performed a beautiful piece on the church organ. Ethan is a young man of many talents. I'm grateful that I had this chance to get to know Ethan. I'm sorry that under the circumstances, we didn't get to spend as much time together as we might ordinarily, but it has been an honor to be his mentor. And without further ado, I will turn it over to Ethan.
In the beginning, there was nothing. Everyone agrees with that. Then, light. This is where the split between scientists and major religions emerge. The scientists believed that it was the Big Bang that created the universe, which in turn the Big Bang was caused by all the matter in the universe arriving at one singularity. This leads to another question. What caused all the matter to be in the same place? Where a few theories for the situation do exist, they all create more questions than answers. One theory is that the matter comes from the entire universe collapsing in on itself, like a sheet in a box, folding. And that creates some questions. Other theories are that all the small molecules inevitably met in one space. Once again, they were all in a limited space. But that too leads to more questions. Is this the first universe? What caused the Big Bang? What created the quarks and small molecules? And how long did it take for the quarks and small molecules to create our universe? Scientists do not know the answer to these questions. And when science fails, religion picks up the pieces. Most major religions agree that God started the universe, or some form of higher deity. I personally believe in a mix between both of these. God started the Big Bang and led to the creation of the universe, but then left the universe as either an experiment or a painter leaving a masterpiece. On a more solemn topic, but a frequently thought about one nonetheless, what happens after you die? Scientists would say the same thing as the beginning, as the end. Darkness. I don't really want to face a reality. When I die, my brain simply stops functioning, so I choose not to. The modern Christian beliefs believe in a heaven and a hell. I don't think there is a hell to punish people for all eternity. I do, however, believe in an afterlife, but not the perfect utopia of the modern Christian beliefs. The afterlife I think of is most similar to our own Earth, but without the major problems. Global warming, racism, classism, sexism, basically every other ism. The other aspect of death is the impact of death and the looming imminence of it. Some people fear death too much, and however those people may live longer, in my opinion, they might not experience as much in life. I'm not saying throw your life away with reckless abandon, but some people do not experience their own life to the fullest. Take me, for example. Who else gets to say they played a church organ in an empty church? Who else said they have tried lobster or Sour Patch Kids ice cream? If you want to know, lobster was not so great. Sour Patch Kids was okay, a little sugary. I've tried many sports, including tennis, baseball, soccer. If you count sailing, that's a sport. I've tried to experience my life to the fullest. And I feel, for my 14 years of life, I've been successful. And this attitude is quite similar to my search for spirituality. With the help of the Building Bridges program in our church, I've experienced many different services and attitudes about God, death, and, well, the unanswerable questions. That led me to the conclusion that spirituality means different things to everyone. For example, some people regularly attend Mass or a traditional service, while usually they're not being forced to go by their parents. And some might take their spirituality and preach it to a congregation, or some just simply find it in a meditation or listening to music. Now, however strange it may seem, the concept of spirituality has a basis in science as well. A study that tracked brain changes while meditating on God showed people who believed in a God have a higher rate of activity in certain areas of their brain while thinking about God, as opposed to an atheist who believes in no God. Now, the way I feel closest to God is not quite in a traditional sense, but I find my own spiritual escape under the night sky. Something about the unanswerable mystery of every single star in the night sky reminds me about, well, the unanswerable mystery of religion and the questions that I don't know if scientists will ever find the answer to. And I feel the most spiritual in the night sky thinking about creation of our planet and, you know, why our planet was fitted most into the Goldilocks zone, which is where life is formed. The stars have always fascinated me, and I've already read a few books on the stars and space, which helped to form my ideas about life, creation, and unanswerable questions. I believe I've rambled on long enough, and I just have one more message to the people of the church community. Stay safe in these trying times. Thank you.
Hi, my name's Kevin Grealish. I've enjoyed getting to know Kevin Barnett. There's a lot of things I like about this young man, especially his name. He's passionate about baseball, playing and practicing year-round. He's a thoughtful and intelligent individual. I've found that Kevin listens carefully to what's being asked of him and gives his best every time, even at 8:30 on Sunday mornings. I hope you enjoy listening to his credo.
I am very fortunate to have been raised the way that I have. My parents have always continued to guide me throughout my life and push me to be the best version of myself. I think one of the best decisions my parents made was raising me and my brother in this congregation. When I was younger, I saw no meaning in coming to church. I was too young to realize how it helped, and I never really paid attention anyway. Now that I'm older, I've realized that this congregation is full of great people, and my experiences here have taught me valuable lessons, which is why I'm grateful that I can be a part of this congregation. The thing I value most in my life is maintaining good relationships. We are constantly interacting with others, whether it's family, a romantic relationship, friends, teachers, etc. Having good relationships with the people around you is a huge key to being the best person that you can be. The cliche is used all the time, but communication is huge. There are a lot of times where it's helpful to communicate with others. I've learned to let my parents know where I am if I'm out with friends. My experience of not informing them and them not being happy has led me to know that I should always tell them what's happening. I've learned that communication is also necessary for a successful romantic relationship. Being comfortable enough to be honest and work things out together makes things a lot easier, and it helps you and your significant other get through tougher times. I think that in life, one of the most important things is respect. Every person is deserving of respect, and respecting the people you interact with helps those relationships flourish. There are limitless ways of where and how you can show respect to people, which shows how important it is to respect the people in your life. The least you can give someone is respect. Respecting people's opinions and ideas are very important to successful collaboration. Respecting friends' choices on doing certain things are important, and higher levels of respect lead to better relationships. There are a lot of times where teenagers are interacting with adults. We're spending time with our parents, teachers, coaches, and other adults in our lives. It is important to be mature when we are interacting with these adults. Once we get to be teenagers, adults don't want to have to babysit us anymore, so behaving well in the class or during practice will help gain more trust and approval from teachers and coaches. Adults expect a level of maturity for us to have in interaction, so being mature around them helps improve the relationships we have with the adults in our lives. I've learned a lot of lessons from people in my life, and I've also learned from experiences that I've had. Some of the not-so-great experiences with others can be the best teachers in regards to improvement. Saying or doing the wrong thing can help you improve and not make the same mistakes again. Growing up in such a comforting community has helped me be able to be myself and continue to improve as a person every day. I'm very grateful to be in the position that I'm in, and I will keep striving to be the best that I can be.
Hi, I'm Jen Robbins. I've known Kaisa Harrington for many years as one of the youngest kids running around with the pack of children at First Parish events. While I wasn't looking, she turned into this mature young adult who is very much her own person. It's been a real pleasure getting to know Kaisa, a serious student, an athlete, she's a runner, like me, and an accomplished player of the flute. Kaisa has a wide variety of interests and a very full schedule. But she is also a very thoughtful person in the real sense of the word. She has thought deeply about what her current beliefs are, knowing that they may change in the future. Some of what we talked about even made me re-examine my own beliefs. Kaisa is both a doer and a thinker. With people like her in the world, I feel optimistic about our future. If you don't already, I think you'll enjoy getting to know her too. And now, here's Kaisa.
I'm Kaisa Harrington. When first beginning to work on our credos in April, we were given a list of questions to spark our interest in what we want to talk about. As I read through the questions, I realized that the biggest beliefs I need to sort out were the ones that involved both my logical and spiritual mind. For these, I was stumped because my beliefs had changed through the years as I learned more about the logical reasoning behind them. For example, whether or not there's a larger force behind the creation of the universe. On questions like these, when I first learned or considered them when I was younger, I loosely answered them with what I thought could be an answer to them. However, as I grew older and learned more science and logic in school, my beliefs would change. For example, when I learned about the Big Bang Theory, my beliefs about the creation of the universe changed. As I continue to grow and learn more, I have no doubt that my beliefs will change, but this last month I had to consider what my beliefs were right now. One of the first things I learned regarding religion was the idea of God. The idea that there was some larger force behind the universe, controlling some assortment of things. Since I had heard about God when I was so young, I didn't think about how it was a matter of opinion. I just kind of took the info and decided that there was God. Despite learning about other religions through the years and what they believe influences the universe, I kept this idea of God with me. However, what I disagreed with many people as I got older was the idea that God was an old white man or even a person. For me, I've never pictured God as a person or any kind of living being. It is a sort of force or other that has influence over us and the world. However, something that I am not sure of is the extent of what God has control over. I do not believe God controls every little bit of our lives. We often determine that, which leads me to my next topic that I mulled over, prayer. Prayer was introduced to me when I was very little, mostly from watching TV shows or reading books. I knew that there were different variations of how one wanted to pray, but what I learned pretty quickly in church class is that one would pray when they were in times of need. For me, that was when it was raining and I had to walk a block from Newman Elementary to get picked up from my mom. If there was rain in the forecast, I would pray that by the time 3:10 rolled around, it wouldn't be raining. Looking back at this, I realized that prayer probably didn't affect this outcome very much, nor was it something that would be listened to and be helped to change. I believe that God listens to prayers. Prayer can be any sort of thought. It doesn't need to be something formal in church. It can be a tiny wish that you think of in your head. However, I believe that God doesn't respond to every single prayer. As much as some might like to believe that God listens and helps everyone, I just don't think that happens. I think that some prayers are more important than others, therefore given a higher priority. I believe the prayers most often responded to are the ones that are made to help the people around the prayer and not just themselves. I also think that it's important to note that prayer doesn't change the minds of others. Like if you're praying to get into a school, it doesn't make a difference. It depends on your application compared to others' applications. Hence, in my opinion, prayer wouldn't make a difference. Prayer is not a solid belief, as not every single prayer is responded to. I don't know the reasoning of why other prayers are chosen over others. I can only speculate. Prayer is not a science, which is why I have such a hard time answering these questions. My thoughts and beliefs generally tend to be about logic and science, and anything that I can't explain after that, I try to reason with my spirituality. Prayer is not any sort of science. It completely relies on one's spiritual beliefs. This is unlike my belief about the creation of the universe. When I was a little, I liked to think that the earth had always been here, and through time, animals and plants and stuff had just come into existence. And I didn't know about evolution back then, so I thought God made animals when God thought animals were needed. Extinct animals were animals that just didn't have an important purpose for the earth anymore. And even when I heard about the Big Bang Theory, I didn't really like the thought of it. Not because I was so devoted to the thought that God had made Earth or something, but because I didn't like the thought that that before the Big Bang Theory, there just wasn't anything. No stars, no space, not even other universes. I always picture a big black void of nothingness. I still don't like thinking about that big void, but I did come to agree that the Big Bang Theory is how the planet, solar system, and the universe came to be. But there are certain things that I believe are God's doing. Like the fact that the Earth is in the Goldilocks zone, the perfect place to be, not too close or too far from the sun, an ideal planet for life to grow on. There is no scientific reasoning for why we happen to be in this spot. I think God had something to do with that. One thing I've always taken for granted while being a Unitarian Universalist was the fact that I can choose what I believe. While attending coming-of-age classes this year, I learned more about what Unitarian Universalists believe in. Although belief might not be the right word, because Unitarian Universalism is about the fact that no one is obligated to believe in any singular belief. This freedom gives me the right to change my beliefs as I grow. And I think it's safe to assume that when I answer these questions again in 10 years, my answers will again evolve from what they are. When I was younger and people asked what religion I was, I answered, and then they would immediately ask, "What's that?" However, I didn't really know what to answer. I would say it's a religion where we have the freedom to choose what we want to believe in, and we accept all beliefs because we realize that there's no way to prove them. And honestly, after going through this course, I think that's a pretty accurate answer. Before I even started to go to church, I was always confused by the concept of religion and people's strong beliefs, because we had no proof of any of it. I didn't get why people disagreed so strongly when this was all speculation. We can try our best to answer them and have strong opinions about what happened, but we don't really know. As I grow older, I'm sure my beliefs will grow and mature, and I think it's important to acknowledge that I may never fully understand my beliefs. I can speculate with some of them, but at the end of the day, there's no way to prove whether or not my answers are right. Being a Unitarian Universalist is about the freedom of belief without judgment, no matter what your beliefs are. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Bob Rands, and I'm working with Max Bonney. This is the third time that I've done coming of age in the last 25 years. Working with Max has been a very humbling experience. It's been a very trying time for all, but Max, who just started a new school in the fall and is a hockey enthusiast, has done a great job. It's very humbling to work with the youth of today. It's really refreshed my faith in the younger generation. Here's Max.
This year, we were forced to think about ourselves and what we believe in. I honestly didn't care much for learning what gods I might believe in, but one thing that did hit me was people. People, in all shapes and ways, help me find who I am. People create who I am through the connections I have with them. Throughout my life, I've had too many connections with people to count. Every day, we're in contact with people, whether it's our friends, family, or strangers. These are the people who influence our lives. They're the people who help form who we are. My family has encouraged me and helped me throughout my life, whether it's helping me with schoolwork, supporting me at every hockey game, or just being there to talk. My parents are amazing. They always know what to say, even if I don't want to hear it. They've helped me in ways I'll never be able to pay them back. I'm also close with my brothers. Even though they can be annoying, they're so nice to have around. Especially being stuck at home, it's nice to have someone to play a game with or chill and watch TV with. My friends have changed me entirely differently way than my family. All my friends affect who I am. They give me a piece of them, and I give them a piece of me. I have friends from all sides of my life. School, sports, old friends, new friends, friends from far away, friends from across the street. They've all made me who I am today and will continue to change me. I started at a new school this year. Going into the year, I knew absolutely no one. With almost a third of the grade being new, the school had a tradition to go to New Hampshire for 2 weeks with the whole grade for an orientation. We camped in the woods at night and had different activities during the day. The grade was split into squads, with each having 6 people. My squad had 3 new kids and 3 returning kids. Throughout the experience, we became close. We had funny talks around the fire at night, we would argue about who had to wash the dishes, and we had deep conversations late at night in our tents. By the end of the 2 weeks, no one could remember who was new or who had been there their whole lives. These few short weeks changed my whole experience the rest of the year. I was able to blend in and have some friends the first day of classes. I felt like I was part of the community even after just arriving. These are the feelings and connections and that relationships with friends can have, even if it's forced. As most things in life, relationships aren't permanent. The people around you are always changing, so never take them for granted. Friends can fall off, but they will always have an impact on your life, no matter how small. I do have some beliefs about this sort of meaning to our lives. I don't know if I believe in God, I'm a pretty scientific person, but what I do believe in is what I can see around me and what I can imagine in my head. The closest thing to God that I can imagine is my own consciousness. That voice in the back of your head that leads you and helps you shape your ideas about life. I've always thought about it as my little God in the back of my head. I've told it things, asked it things. Of course, I didn't know what I was doing, but it felt right. That voice helps you make decisions and work through problems. But in reality, the people around you are the ones who help you get over those hard decisions. I'm grateful for all the people around me in my life and how they've changed me. I could never ask for a better family or community to grow up in. I don't think I'll ever truly know what I believe in. My beliefs are always changing, and so am I. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Elliot Jacowski, and it's my pleasure to introduce Sebi Gallo. Sebi and I first got to know each other when we began this project, and I've learned a lot of very interesting things about him, and we had an immediate connection through music. Sebi has played guitar since the first grade. He takes regular lessons, and he loves to play blues and jazz, which is near and dear to my heart. He also played clarinet while he was in middle school. He also loves to swim, which was a passion of his father, and he takes after his father in that manner. He is on the swim team at school, and he also belongs to a swim club. He's good at and interested in math and sciences, and looks forward to doing something related to computers. So I'm happy to introduce him to you all.
My father often tells a story about me when I was 5. When we saw construction workers working on the roads, I asked him, if men made the roads, who made the earth? My father, of course, didn't know how to answer. Since then, I've thought many times about how I would have answered. On one hand, we live in a simulation. There's a chance because based on how far technology has come in the last 40 or 50 years, in 1,000 years, it's possible we could replicate our own reality. So that increases the chances of us living in a simulation. On the other hand, there could also be infinite dimensions. Even if there is just a nanomillimeter difference in one of these alternate dimensions, I could be the smartest and the richest person in the world, or a homeless runaway. In another dimension, there could be no poverty because the whole world is communist. Even if we're living in a simulation or one of many dimensions, it shouldn't take away from the fact that we should care about each other. That human beings should care about each other because in all of these simulations, we still feel pain and loss. We should still work hard and we should still strive to be what we want to be. In a simulation, the larger forces would be whomever made the simulation. But if this is the base reality, it is more likely that something started creation but doesn't direct it. The Big Bang Theory makes the most sense to me because I don't believe there is something directing life. People are free to determine what happens in the world, so laws are important to keep people from making the wrong decisions. People are inherently good, but we still need laws for a small percentage of people who take advantage of others. Science is important, but still doesn't have all the answers. This pandemic is proof. But the pandemic also shows that we could stop global warming, reduce pollution, and consume less. But even before this pandemic, I've often thought about what happens when we die, because there isn't an answer. When I was younger, I thought that whatever someone believed happens after death would happen to them. In other words, everybody is right, whether they believe in heaven or believe they are reincarnated. Science, on the other hand, tells us that our neurons stop functioning when we die. Our thoughts are just chemicals in our brain. People shouldn't be afraid of death. The Latin American holiday of Dia de los Muertos is useful because it reminds us that death is a part of life. Without the reality of death, the human race would be like animals, whose only motivation is finding something to eat and where to sleep. Because there is a reality of death, people are motivated to make a difference. For many people, this means creating a family and finding love. But small differences are also important every day, like kindness. When I went to Arizona, I saw how undocumented refugees are treated. Legally, they have no pathway to citizenship, but they still deserve to have their basic needs met, like having enough food, feeling safe, and being able to work to take care of their family. Those with power should take care for people without power. This means people who need help should receive help. People who are hungry should get food. People who are in dangerous situations should find safe places to live. And people without a place to live should be able to get shelter. In the end, I've decided your moral responsibility is to love others, all people, and to love and take care of the earth for future generations.
Wow. Thank you, Ethan. Thank you, Kevin. Thank you, Kaisa. Thank you, Max. Thank you, Sebi. I've said it many times before, and I say it again today. My favorite part of the coming of age service is the diversity of the credos and how they speak so perfectly to the essence of the wonderful young people I have sincerely enjoyed getting to know. Ethan, Kevin, Kaisa, Max, and Sebi come before us today, having grown far beyond the children they once were. With each new day, they learn more about themselves, their world, their beliefs, and what makes their hearts and spirits soar. As do we. This brings us to the time in the service that is hardest to do virtually, the part where we share our love and affirmation. And so, role modeling knowing when and how to ask for help, I reached out to their parents. And what a beautiful gift this is turning out to be. As you listen to their parents' messages of love and pride, combined with hopes and dreams, imagine both sending the same heartfelt positive energy to our youth and saving some for ourselves. Here they are.
Hey, Ethan. We've always been proud of you. We've loved watching you grow up. But the more and more you become a young man, the more that I just like hanging out with you. You're becoming a buddy, a pal. We have the same sense of humor, the same sense of adventure. I wish for you that you actively use your gifts to be the and choose to be the person you want to be.
I've always been proud of you. And I'm proud of the way that you are thoughtful and insightful and an independent thinker. And I hope that you find a community at each stage of your life that supports you but challenges you to be the best version of yourself. And also a space where you can rise above the everyday and appreciate the awe and wonder of the world around us.
Hi, Kevin. Feels kind of odd sitting here making a video for coming of age instead of being there in person. A couple of months ago, looking ahead to May 17th, mostly involved waiting for your baseball schedule and hoping that it wouldn't conflict with this church service. But things changed in ways we couldn't have imagined, and here we are. So what we want to say is how much we love you, how lucky we feel to be your parents, and how proud we are of you.
As you move on from today, and as your world expands, stay true to yourself. Remember the things you've learned here at First Parish, and continue to examine your beliefs and adapt your credo. Coming of age is over, but it's also just beginning.
We love you.
Hey, Kaisa, I love you. Sorry Dad and I can't be together making this video, but I'll do my best. As you go through coming of age and kind of make this transition from childhood into young adulthood, I wanted to give you a few thoughts on my hopes and dreams for you. As you move out of childhood, I'm really going to miss the young, spunky, wild, crazy, laughing little girl that you've been. But I'm really looking forward to getting to know the incredibly talented, smart, engaging and engaged young woman that you're becoming. You are a force to reckon with. You always have been, and you always will be. My hopes and dreams for you over the next, 10 years as you go through high school, college, and into your young adult years is that you always trust yourself, always celebrate the force that you are. And I think the most important thing for all of us going through life is to always have community. You'll always have your family. You'll always have this phenomenal community that we've met and engaged with at church. But I really look forward to getting to know the friends that you make in high school and college and beyond. And I just always hope that you form a great community that you can lean in on and count on.
Hi, my name is Jackie Boney.
And I'm Rolfo Boney.
We are the proud parents of Max Boney, who has grown up in First Parish.
Max, you are a great young man. I hope you dream and aspire to find what brings you joy and purpose in your life, inspiring you to achieve something that impacts the world beyond you by becoming your best self.
We love you and want to leave you with this departing quote by Dr. Seuss. You have brains in your head, you have feet in your shoes, you can steer yourself any direction you choose. You're off to great places. Today is your day. Your mountain is waiting, so set on your way.
Hi, Sebi. We are so proud of you for this milestone you've reached and the young man you have become. You have built your talents through dedication and a sense of humor. We are so proud of the musician, the swimmer, and the hardworking student you've become.
You're also a thoughtful and loving son, brother, grandson, nephew, and cousin. As we consider your future, we know there are many directions that your interests may take you. So we hope that you will build on one of your many talents to have a happy, healthy, and satisfying life with a family of your own.
Success can be measured in many ways, and we hope you find a career that is not merely economically beneficial, but also fulfilling for your soul. We hope you can continue to travel and enjoy the wonders of nature, explore new cultures, and learn more about the world's incredible history.
We know First Parish has been an important part of your life since you were born, and we also want to thank Roberta and Elliot for working with you and ensuring the coming of age continued. While your future religious life is certainly up to you, we also hope you find a religious community like First Parish that will continue to engage, teach, and comfort you during challenging times like these.
We love you.
As I said, what an incredible affirmation of our youth and of us as a beloved community. I am filled with awe, love, pride, inspiration, and gratitude. I represent the entire First Parish community as we congratulate Ethan, Kevin, Kaisa, Max, and Sebi. This is the moment when we formally welcome each of these young people as emerging adults into our community of faith. They have all done impressive work, and we offer our joyful affirmation of their achievement. We welcome you as the next generation of our community. May this church always be a spiritual home for you. We celebrate your spirit and strength. We celebrate in you our hope for our future. We pledge our continued love and support. We make this joyful pledge to stand together in our Unitarian Universalist faith with all the blessings and responsibility that come with being a part of a liberal, open-minded, justice-seeking religion. Join us at Social Hour today to see the youth receive their congratulatory gifts. Meanwhile, I am pleased to present and celebrate with you our newest young adults at First Parish.
Please join us in singing hymn number 1021, Lean on Me. As we extinguish our chalice, please join me in reading the words printed in your order of service from Unitarian Universalist minister, Reverend Elizabeth Selley Jones. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, nor the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again. I share with you these closing words adapted from the writing of Kendall Gibbons. Daughters and sons of love, sisters and brothers of truth, may you go with courage upon the path of life that lies before you. Keep a pure heart, a free mind, a steadfast will, and a joyous song for the journey. May you be simple in your desires, loyal in your friendships, and strong in all tribulation. Be proud of your adulthood and serve the highest good you find with your whole devotion. May life reward you with fruitful happiness, and may you never forget the ideals to which you have pledged yourself here today and the fullness of love by which you are surrounded and blessed. Amen and blessed be.